everyone. Here we are with another episode of Big Sky Hobby Corner. We're going to move forward with our PT-20 fuselage build. We're just about done with that, and we'll be moving on to the wing. What we're going to do today, we're going to establish the holes in our landing gear block. There's a couple tricks and techniques we use in the holes of that. Fortunately, this kit actually came with a drill guide. It's a little piece of wood that you set in the groove of the wires, and it has places where you mark your holes, you drill them out. And I'm going to cover a couple things that aren't necessarily covered in the manual on making your landing gear wires fit properly in the fuselage when it comes to that time. After that, the manual wants us to install our engine and the motor mount. We're not quite there yet because we're still saving our pennies to purchase our transmitter, receiver, servos, engine, and other accessories that we're going to need. But that's okay. We can work around this. It's not a problem. I've done it 100 times. And I'm going to show you how we do that. It's real simple. You can just skip it and come back to it when you get your stuff in. What do you say? I put my coffee down and we get started, okay? I'll see you in a minute. Okay, here we are. We're looking at the bottom of our fuselage. This is our landing gear block that we epoxied in on the last episode. And it's really important before we do this step that the epoxy is fully cured. It's not even sticky. It's hard like plastic is what you want to see. Now, what they included with this kit, not everybody does. Great Plains really did good on this one. We have a drill guide. It's just a little piece of light ply. It has a couple dimples in it, right here and in here, to let us know where we need to drill our holes. Okay, hang on here. And it doesn't matter which one is forward or aft. All you got to do is slide that in there. Okay, just set it in the hole. And if it doesn't fit, that's fine. We can take care of that. All we'll need to do is just sand one side down a little. And just knock a little off one side, and then we'll knock a little off the other side. You do that, that way you kind of trim it down evenly. So you're still kind of maintaining the center. I mean, I know it really doesn't matter a whole lot because this is just for wheels. And I know you probably, oh, it's just for the wheels. Well, you know, we fly airplanes, we don't drive them. Okay, we're just going to leave it set in there like that. And what that does, this sets our distance in from the outside of the airplane on where we're going to set our wires. Now, the manual says we're going to drill a pilot hole of a 3/32 or 3/32 size drill bit here and here. Like so. We'll do that. We'll come back. I'll change position of the camera and we'll do that. And then we're going to come back with a 5/32. Or a 3/16. Excuse me. It's a 5/32 because this manual is both for the PT-40 and the PT-20, so it throws both sides out there. If we're building the 40, we'd use the 3/16, but we're building the PT-20, which takes the 5/32 drill bit. So we're going to drill our pilot holes with our drill bit guide, and then we'll come back, remove the drill bit guide, and then we'll open the holes up with a 5/32 drill bit. Okay. Got my handy dandy Makita here with a 3/32 drill bit. Just a little bitty tiny guy, but if you see where the location of the holes are going to be, we want it to be small for a pilot hole. And the important thing is, when we go to drill our hole, we want to be parallel and square. Parallel with our fuselage sides and square to the length of the fuselage. Okay, we don't want to be laying over or anything like that, drill a crooked hole, because when we go to install our landing gear wires, that's really going to cause some problems with the way everything sets up. So, let's go ahead and drill our pilot holes. Yeah, it looks pretty good. That epoxy sure held on to it there, didn't it? It's okay. These are some really good drill bits, too. Now, partially, I'm using a friction chuck as well. All right.
There's our pilot holes.
Go ahead and get that bad boy out of there. There we go. We have our pilot holes for our landing gear wires. Okay. Now we're back with our 532 drill bit. Now we're going to drill our holes. Now these are the holes that the wires are actually going to go into. Okay. So we want to make sure that we follow our pilot hole as close as we can. Okay. And if you notice, we're pretty close to the edges of our rail. So we really kind of want to just be nice to it. Man, I think I'm going to switch to a Jacob's chuck. All the way through. Beautiful. That's some of that epoxy that rolled up a burr there. No biggie. We can get rid of that with our hobby knife. Now here is a hint that we're going to use because, I'll show you right quick. On our landing gear wire, I'll pull one out and show you. Oops, that's the nose wheel. You know, this is our wire that we're going to, that's our landing gear, okay? You notice we have a 90 degree right here, comes across the bottom of the airplane, comes out the side, and this is where our wheel is going to go, okay? Hang on, let me turn this down. Okay, like I was saying, this is the part that's going to go in the hole that we just drilled. This is going to go across the bottom of the fuselage. This is going to come out at 45 degrees, and we're going to have another 45 degree bend right here, and this is where our wheel and wheel collars are going to go. Now, if we take this bad boy, we stick it in the hole as is, and it's a pretty snug fit, okay? What you want it. You don't want your wheels falling out. That's as far as we're going to get in there, okay? Got a little bit of room to go, but see, the reason that does that, thing out of there. If you look, we got a radius right here, okay? Well, our hole and our block are square, okay? Because we drilled a good hole. That's not going to allow that to seep down in there. So what we're going to do, we're going to cut some clearance to clear this radius. A couple ways you can do that. You can go in there with your X-Acto or your hobby knife and cut that out. But I'm going to take this perfectly good hole we just cut and ruin it. Now what I did, I took my drill bit, laid it in our hole sideways at an angle, and pulled the trigger. I'm going to go ahead and do this one while we're here. Now I'm not pushing in on the drill, I'm just letting the side of the drill bit cut. Okay, we're not pushing forward, we're actually cutting sideways. If you look, what that did, that cut us some clearance. That's a clearance angle for the radius in our wire. Now, you can come back and do that several times, okay? It doesn't all have to be done in one. You can push it to fit. Okay, let's get lined up, see what we look like. Okay, our hole's a little tight at the end on that one. No biggie. Just open it up. Go straight down. And just wiggle your drill bit a little bit. That'll open it up. And if it just drops in, that's fine. Of course, we want a tight fit. Okay. I didn't quite go as deep as I wanted, and see, if you look inside the fuselage, the blocks that we installed, that's what those are there for, okay? Just give us more bite. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to open these up from this end a little bit as well.
Okay.
We could bump up to the next drill bit size because in the set I have, it goes by 30 seconds. So we could open it up by a 32. But I'm pretending we're not. We don't have that convenience. Now look at there. Boom. Just like that. Now the other wire is going to come in through that hole and come out the other side. And after we monocoat it, get it covered, we're going to set our block or set our wires, and then we're going to have two nylon straps come across and hold these in. And why are we doing it that way instead of bolting them in? Remember, this is a trainer plane, and it's built and designed to have weak points, crumble points like you would, or crush points like you would in a car. I would rather have the landing gear fall off in a bad landing as opposed to ripping the whole bottom of the fuselage off. Those are built in, those are designed and built in fail points. So the repair could actually almost be done at the field if you had the parts with you. That's why they're designed like that. Okay.
Okay, here's the part where we're going to deviate from our manual a little bit. Okay, we drilled our blocks. Okay. And we're ready for wire. Now they want us to build our engine mount and our engine and get all that lined up. Well, problem. We're saving our pennies to buy our engine and our radio gear. So we can't really do that just yet. So we're going to go ahead and skip this part and we can come back to it. And I'm going to, there really is no trick to it. I mean, you just skip it and move along. And we'll come back to it when we get our engine. I think we're going to go ahead and order our stuff sometime soon. I've got enough money saved up to buy it all. And I'll walk you guys through that in another video. Okay, the next process we're going to skip as well. They want us to go ahead and start lining up and setting our tail feathers on the airplane, the vertical and horizontal stabilizer along with the elevator and rudder. And here's why I don't do it like that. It's not just for this specific airplane. It's not the lack of supplies. It's simply the fact it's going to make covering a bitch. It's going to be miserable having to cover your airplane like this. I did two or three this way, and I mean, it was always a pain in the butt. It never did come out looking right. So a friend of mine back home in Duncan, Oklahoma, he says, what you do, you build all your everything up, and then we cover it, and then we assemble everything. So when we get to that point, like after we get our wing done, we'll go ahead and cover all of our components. And then we'll put everything together, build it up in an ARF or an almost ready to fly state, and then we'll do that. Now let's see what's next in this treasure trove. Okay, there's the setup and alignment and everything. All right, build the wing. That is the next section we're going to do. And in order to do that, I've got a train wreck to clean up right quick. So let me go ahead and get my workbench cleaned up, and we'll get some parts gathered up. And this is the part where I said in an earlier video where we build on top of our plans, where foam board and wax paper and work surface flatness is very important. This is where it comes into play. So let me reset, get my workbench cleaned up a little bit, get some room to work, gather up our parts, and I'll be right back.
Okay, before we get started, a couple things I want to cover before we get started on the wing section of our build. This is the absolute most critical part of the build we're going to do. And the reason is the construction of our wing will determine how our airplane will fly. If we build it warped and crooked and just kind of hodgepodge together, our airplane's not going to fly very well, and you're going to have a real handful. Remember, you're learning how to fly. You want to make this as easy on yourself as possible. And I've got a good flat table. I've got a good flat piece of foam board down for our pins. So remember, let's not hurry through this. Take our time. Let's do it right. And believe it or not, you get organized, you roll everything out, it'll actually fall into place really easy for you. So let's get our plans out of the box, roll them out, and get some wax paper and get everything nailed down and get to building. All right, here we are. This is our set of rolled plans that came with the kit, rubber banded together, and are rolled together pretty tight, which is a good thing. They fit in the kit really well that way, but also it makes our planes want to stay rolled up. No big deal. So let's go ahead and unroll everything. And of course they do send a two size drawing.
of everything. Now, let me tell you why. You're wondering why we didn't really resort to our fuselage plans. Well, didn't need to. But it has all of our formers, our firewall, fuselage top, bottom, and sides, and how the servos. It gives you a full-size comparison of what everything should look like when we go to do our final assembly. We will be resorting back to this when we go to set up control surfaces and all that good stuff. But I just wanted to point out that that is in there. And also, the handy thing about it is the simple fact that if we bang up our airplane and crash it, we can actually resort back to our plans to build new parts. We can run up here. We don't have a local hobby shop that we can just run to. However, we do have a hardware store here. It's Ace Hardware of Polson. They carry light ply and balsa wood, which I found out pretty handy. You know, I'll crack one up and need to build some parts. And, well, that's where I go because I can run right down there and get it. You can also go to towerhobbies.com, of course, and buy a supply of balsa or light ply, whichever one you may need. And now, the meat and potatoes. Now see what I mean? We're wanting to stay rolled up. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to fold these in half lengthwise, and then I'll put them down on the building table, and we'll pin it down. That'll help it stay flat. Okay, I'll be right back. Okay, before I put down our wax paper, this is my plan. It's rolled out, and we have a wing half here, and this is the left wing panel. One thing I want to point out that's really, really important is that we don't build two of the same panels. We'll build a panel, pull it off, flip the plan over, and build the other wing panel. It's on the other side here. I've done that before. I've built two left wing panels. Don't do that, okay? Because then you're screwed. But I have our plan rolled out here on our foam board. I put four T-pins in the corners to hold it down because it's a rolled plan and always wants to curl up. And I also have it folded up in half as well, lengthwise, exposing one half of our build. And the way this works, we build a left wing panel, a right wing panel, and then we'll come back and join the two. And then we'll fiberglass or epoxy cloth the two halves together with a dihedral in it. That's also a very critical part, but we'll cover that in another video. We'll go ahead and get this bad boy started. Okay, here we are. We got our plans out. We're looking in our manual. We got our parts here. We'll set these aside for a second. First things first. Sorry about that. Wax paper. Now, you don't necessarily have to cover all of your building surface with wax paper. We just want to cover where we're going to be working. So we're going to be working from here to here. So I at least want to cover those, that area, with wax paper. And I always like to put the purls down. This helps it lay out flatter. Perfect. We got enough to cover everything. And we'll get a couple more T-pins. Can't have enough T-pins. And then we'll pin our wax paper down. I apologize if I'm a little goofier than normal. I've been under the weather all week. If you follow my personal Facebook page, you notice I put a picture of my oldest son up. He works at the Boys and Girls Club, and one of the little rugrats there got him sick, and he brought it home and shared it with the rest of the family. So my poor wife is sick as well. So here we are. We got our wax paper down. And first thing we need to start out with is our main spar. Now this is basically our balance point of this wing. Okay. And is like the backbone of the wing. It's the strong part of the wing. So it's critical that we get this part right. And the spars for this particular airplane, okay, they're a spruce, and if you look down it, there's a trough cut in it, okay? That's where our webbing is going to set, okay? This wing is built different than a typical wing. It's actually very easy. So easy, you kind of forget how you build your old wings. But one thing we want to do, we want to make sure we look down it and make sure it's straight, okay? And this one, this particular one is really straight. But if you notice, it's got some burrs rolled up. And I want to go ahead and take care of that and get my 3M sanding pad. And just, we're not trying to change the shape. We're just wanting to smooth it out a little bit, okay? Does it affect how it flies? Not really. As far as the burrs and stuff poking up there. But it's peace of mind, okay? Nobody's really going to see it, but you know it's there. You know what's underneath. Okay, we got that straightened out. And on our plan here, this is where our spar goes. It even says right there, spar, S-P-A-R, really big. And it's really important that we line it up. And I'll show you a little trick. Let me get my T-pins here. I'll grab a T-pin. And I'll put it just outside the line, the diameter of the T-pin, to act as a stop, something we slide up to and stop. And then I'm going to get a few more T-pins, and I'm going to put one, if I sneeze also, forgive me, because I mean, they just come up and get me. Like that. I want to do the same here for now, okay? And when we're setting these T-pins, it's really important not to put a T-pin where we're going to have to set a rib, because then we have to pull it and move it. And once you establish a part on your table, you don't want to have to do that. So what I'll do, I put one on the end, skip the bay, put one on the front, skip a bay, put one on the back side. And what this does, this kind of builds a trough, if you will, for the spar to set in. You'll notice in the plans that it says to pin it down, which is fine, but have you ever tried to drive a pin through that? It's not the easiest thing in the world to do. Now, this is our sheeted area. We're going to come back and do the sheeting after we get the wing half built. So, we'll get that down in there. And now, we just kind of weave our spar into our pins. You don't have to forget the music I've got going in the background. I'm the kind of builder or shop hand, whatever you want to call it, that has to have music going in the background. And I didn't in the last video because YouTube got butthurt because the Eagles came on and I didn't have a copyright for it or whatever. Whatever reason. So I've got royalty-free music playing in the background. That's why it's kind of different. So there we are. And good to go. Okay, I've got all my parts not punched out, but they're here. We have our wing ribs. Kind of hard to see in the camera. We got twos and threes. They're numbered. We'll get those out of the way. That's not the part we need next. What we need now is our shear web, okay? Now, a lot of airplanes, they're actually little individual balsa pieces that you come in and set in between the wing ribs. Not so much on this one. It's actually a solid piece, if you will, that sets in the trough of our spar. Okay. Set that on to the side. I'm going to set these off to the side for the time being. We're going to come back and poke some ribs out here in a minute. And let's see. We want to have just one of these. We'll set that one off to the side because we'll use it on our other wing. Come back and I'm going to clean this up a little bit. Okay, here we are. We have our die cut slotted shear ready to go. And what we need to do, this is a couple things to cover. The inside or on our left wing panel, the right side from the back, the part that goes to the airplane, it's known it as the root. And the part that goes out, that pokes out in the middle of nowhere, is known as the wing tip, okay? Now, on our slotted, or our shear web, we have a notched end, or a slotted end right here, okay? And we want that to go to the tip, because we're going to have a wing rib laying there. So we'll just lay it right in there. We don't glue it in just yet. Remember how I was talking trial fitting everything before we add glue? It's really important. Okay, there is that part. Okay, before we move on to our next step, we want to sort our wing ribs. There are two different types that we're going to be using in our wing halves. We've got twos and threes. That's what they're labeled as. And it's really hard to see. I'm going to find my pen here. But it's actually embossed on the wing rib. Like so. Okay. I just highlighted it there for you so you can see it. And with this particular wing, our inner ribs, there's three of them. Actually, there's three ribs, two different types. We have R2s and then an R1C. Okay. Our R1C is a significantly shorter rib for our wing joiners, and it's got a different cut into it. Then we have our R2 wing ribs, which are going to be inside of our sheeting, and the rest of them are going to be R3s. And then we're going to have an R2 down here at the end. Two R2s at the end, I'm sorry. So, what we want to do, we want to go ahead and sort these out. I have kids upstairs. And that's two. Okay, now that we have all of our wing ribs sorted and stacked, R2s and R3s, we're going to take them one at a time and we're going to place them according to the plan. Now, I'm not going to bore you to death with making you watch me sand and place every single rib, but I will do a couple here. And what I want to do, these are die cut, they come in a die cut sheet. We poke them out carefully because they will break if you don't if you get too rough with them, you know, don't use the gorilla technique. I'm just going to pick one at a time. Our first two ribs we're going to set down here at the tip are R2s. So I'm going to pick up an R2. I'm going to inspect it. Just make sure there's not a whole bunch of burrs. And then place it. Again, we're not gluing anything into place yet. We're just fitting everything, okay? That rib looked pretty good. We didn't need to sand it, and I placed it. Okay. This one actually looks pretty good too. And we'll place it. Okay, those are R2s. Now we have R3s. I'm going to pick an R3. That actually looks really good. Just a little thing there. And just slide it together. You know, it's really cool. Everything just locks together, tab A to slot B kind of thing. And it works really well. I'm going to go back and set all these ribs and then we'll be right back. Okay, here we are. We have all of our R1 and R2 ribs in place. And now we're going to put the top spar in. And again, remember our spars have the slotted on one side. They have the slot on one side. And you know, they're still kind of rough from the mill or where they process these things. So we want to kind of go over it and sand it down. Make it smooth. Now this is where one of our main monocoat or covering attachments is going to be. So we do want this thing to be pretty smooth because it will show through our monocoat. This is the two spars, the upper and lower spars, are vital parts of our wing. Want to make sure they're straight and everything lines up like they're supposed to. So we'll just slide it in here. Now remember, we're not glued into place yet. And the reason, it's simple, we just want to make sure everything fits the way it's supposed to. Before we have a bunch of stuff glued into place, we may have to sand to make an adjustment here or there. Which is, it's kind of a common thing. We'll place everything, and what I'm looking for, I want this spar to be flush with our ribs. Okay, of all the R3. Now where the R2s are, they're actually a little shorter to allow for the sheeting, okay?
We're pushing down, we're seated all the way. That actually looks really good. When we come back to glue it, we will actually add some weights to the wing to hold everything in place. Now, one thing to remember as we're building here, rib placement. They may not always line up 100%. They may be to one side of the line or another. Remember, these things are cut in the factory. It could have been a Friday, could have been a guy's last day, whatever the case may be. It may be off just a touch. And that's actually kind of okay. I mean, as long as we don't wind up with a rib in the middle of where we're supposed to be, we're fine. And also, balsa wood is it's a very porous wood. The moisture, when they cut the balsa wood, and the time they package it, and it sets on the shelf, the hot and the cold can cause our wood to expand and contract, and it may not always go back. So when we have tab A, slot B, into hole C, it can vary our locations a little bit. So if we're, you know, just like to one side of our line or another, that's fine. However, we do want them straight and we do want them square. And we'll get to that point here in just a minute. Okay, here we are. It's time to attach our forward spar. Now, this is going to be a really tight fit. It's a piece of hardwood, basswood. Really long, square piece. And that's going to attach in front of our main spar. Now, what I've done, I've already started laying it in, and it is a really tight fit. And that's okay. We do kind of want a tight fit. That way, nothing really has an opportunity to move around on us. But it's just loose enough to where we can come back and make our adjustments. Now, if we poke out from our root or our tip, also moved our forward pins because they were actually in the way. I didn't think about that in the beginning. But we want to make sure we're all the way down. And that is our forward spar. Now notice I've got a whole bunch of excess hanging out with our spars, our forward top and bottom spar. That's fine. We'll saw all that off in the end. That's when our razor saw will come in really handy. Again, if you are curious about some of the building tools and materials that we're using, please revert back to our building supply video. And I cover a lot of that stuff in that video. Okay, one thing that I didn't cover earlier that I probably should have. We have our leading edge and trailing edge stock. These two already came prepared. This is our leading edge. See the round shape? That's what makes it aerodynamic. It's going to go in the front of our wing. Now, the way these come, they're actually joined by a thin sheet of balsa like so. But these two already came separated. So I'm not going to worry about those at this time. But here's the trailing edge, which is actually our next step. It's joined by a thin piece of balsa. What you have to do, get your hobby knife and come in and very carefully separate. It doesn't have to be a perfect line because we're going to sand away all that stuff in the middle and on the edges. So, just like so. And what I'm going to do right quick, all these parts that are poking up right here, I'm going to get my sandpaper and sand those down and make it a nice piece of wood to work with. So I'll be right back when I get that done. Okay, here we are. Got my trailing edge sorted or separated and sanded down. And it's time to set it. But before we do that, a couple things we need to do. We need to shim our R2 ribs by placing 332 shim stock underneath the end of our ribs, okay, out here on the trailing edge. Remember, leading edge, trailing edge. And miraculously, our ribs are 332. They're 332nd thick. So you can grab a scrap piece off of your die cut sheet. And what I'm going to do, I'm just going to snap a piece long enough to go under these two. We're not flat against there, that's fine, because we're going to weight this down, okay, before we go to gluing stuff. And then I want to snap another piece long enough to go under these two. Okay, and the purpose of that is to allow room for our sheeting that we're going to do. Okay, now we're going to take our trailing edge, and just like our web, we got a notched end. That's going to go to the tip. What I'll do, I'll start in here. Start at one side. It doesn't matter. You can start at the tip if you want. And then I'm going to grab a couple of pins to make this a little easier here. Just set one there. I'll set one there. That'll keep our wing from sliding around. I just want to insert each rib as we go down the line into the slot and getting them started. You don't have to seat them just yet so we don't break nothing, okay? And what this does, this is really nice because it's like they're taking care of the alignment for us, okay? All right, we're gonna make sure we're all the way in, make sure we have enough poking out past our root rib here. And we'll grab a pin, and this is balsa wood, it's a little easier to pin through. We look real good right here, and while I'm holding it together with a little bit of pressure on my fingers, I'm gonna go ahead and pin this down to the plan, right through the wood and everything. That's fine, it won't show through the covering when we go to cover it. I'm just gonna go down the way and make sure we're seated, and if you have enough pins, we're seated all the way through here. I'm gonna pin it right between those two ribs. We'll grab another pin. We're seated, 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 not seated. So, push all that down, slide it forward, get seated, put a pin. And there's no specific pattern that has to be followed, just as long as we're seated all the way against our ribs, okay? We got our shim stock underneath there. And then we'll pin it down there. And since our end R2 ribs out here just flopping around in space, I'm gonna go ahead and add a couple extra pins. I'm gonna go ahead and pin our trailing edge down to the board. Make sure that's all aligned. And I'm going to stick a pin here because we're, again, our ribs out here just kind of flopping around. I mean, you can't see that well. There we go. Okay, it's just out here flopping around, so I'm just going to add a couple pins to kind of assist it, if you will. Hold it in place like so. All right. Okay, this is where the magic happens. We're about to have a wing. We got all our ribs in place, our spars are in place, our webbing is in place, our trailing edge is in place, our shim stock is where it needs to be. And this is the opportunity that we have to make sure that everything is in the correct spot. Okay, we got a little bit of a bow here. That's fine. Get you some weight. Okay, this weighs about 3 pounds. What I'm gonna do, I'm just gonna kind of balance it right there, okay? Everything is down against our plans. We're good and straight now, okay? That's just a chunk of material I had. I've got a little machine shop here at the house, so that's a, I've always got little bits of material that are handy for weights. This is just something I grabbed and it seemed to work perfect, so it just kind of hangs out here in the shop or in the house with me while we're building. Okay, everything looks good. We're good to go. One more thing I want to check. I visually looked, it looked good, but we're going to go ahead and come back with our little square and just come back and look at each rib and make sure we are up and down. Now we should be because everything was slot and locked, but there's still a possibility of everything kind of rotating inside those slots. So we just want to make sure we're square. It just helps have a better looking wing and a better functioning wing. A lot of people don't really understand that an airplane wing is actually a machine. It produces lift. Okay, it's in the shape of the airfoil. I may make a video. Yeah, why don't you guys do that? If you're watching, if you want to know how airplanes fly, let me know. We'll make a video on how airplanes fly, going into the wing detail, why they have this shape, what's the purpose behind it, and how it's a machine that actually produces lift. It's actually a pretty neat theory. We're getting into physics a little bit, but it actually works. Those are actually pretty good. I set those earlier, so that's no big thing. Awesome. Cool. All right, everything looks really good. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to start gluing. I'm going to go where each shear is, put a drop of glue on the wing rib, the shear web, and into the spar all the way down. Okay, we're going to glue the top of the spar, and we're going to come back and we're going to glue the trailing edge, the ribs to the trailing edge. Okay, one thing I'm kind of checking is our ribs should be inside our trailing edge, not poking up above or below. It's just less sanding we have to do later on. All right, let's get some gluing done here. Gotta be careful. This is okay. We got everything glued down. All of our ribs are square, straight, and glued. Our weight did our job. It held everything nice and straight after we glued. And now it's time to place our leading edge. Like our trailing edge and our shear web, we've got a notched end, which will go out on the end. You want to go ahead and sand it down that way. It's nice and smooth. Remember, it's peace of mind. And it's going to be a tight fit, which is what you want. All right. I'll revert back to our manual right quick, take a look. Just making sure I was doing this right. We'll place our leading edge. We want to make sure the bottom of the leading edge is actually touching the plane. We got a little space up here. That's fine. We're going to form that later in the build, okay? So out here on the tip, I want to make sure our rib is in contact where it needs to be. And then we'll glue it. Boom, like so. Okay, we're up against it. We're touching a little bit of glue. You can actually watch the glue run down the front of the rib where it's contacting the leading edge. I guarantee you we are gluing to our wax paper that's above our plan. That's why we put that down. I'm really excited we get to order the rest of our stuff today. Actually, I may just do it Monday. Maybe tomorrow, who knows. But I've saved up enough money to do so. Made the kids go out and rake some yards and shovel some snow so I can have money to do this. I'm just kidding. Good idea though. Okay, our
all of our pieces are in place. We're glued, and it looks pretty good. I'm going to take about 10 minutes. We're going to let this glue dry, because I believe next we're going to actually pull this thing off the plans, do some sawing and sanding, and I'll see you here in just a little bit. All right, all of our glue is dried, and before we move on, before we actually remove our wing panel from the plans, we have a decision to make. We need to decide what type of airplane we're going to build. Are we going to build a sport model, or are we going to build something that's a trainer? If this is your first airplane, I highly suggest you build the trainer portion of this. Now, what I have in my hand here are our dihedral gauges. I'm going to show you how to mark those here in just a second. But one of them, if you notice, we line them up, has a steeper angle than the other one. Okay, we're going to build the one with the steeper angle. It's the for the more dihedral. Makes the airplane a lot more stable and a lot easier to fly, and you'll find it really handy when we're learning how to land. So let me reset, and hi, Nikki. That's my daughter. I'll reset the camera. We're going to take our wing A dihedral gauge, and we'll mark our dihedral, and then we'll be able to pull our wing panel off the pan and plans and continue. Would you like to say anything?
No.
Okay, here we are. This is a fun one. Okay, I'm going to show you how to do this on our main spars, and then off camera I'm going to go ahead and do the leading edge and trailing edge. But if you'll notice, our wing on our plan, we have our root rib, which is depicted by this right here. We're not going to add that just yet. But what we are going to do, we're going to have to mark for our dihedral, so when we join our wing halves together, we have that. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to take our dihedral gauge and make sure you have the angle where the top of the wing is going to be further back than the bottom of the wing. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to slide this to the furthermost outline of our panel. And just as simple as 1, 2, 5, I'm going to draw a line just like that. And boom, that sets our dihedral. Now I'm going to repeat the same process. On our leading edge as well. All that line will line up when we get her cut. We're going to come back with our razor saw a little later and cut these. Okay, we have that set. Okay, we have all everything marked, and we have removed all of our pins. Now, why we use lax paper, I think I've said it 100 times, I'm going to say it again, is so that our glue doesn't stick to our plans and tear our plans up. Because the reason why we want to preserve our plans, what if later on down the road we're flying, we get confident, and then boom, we have an accident, we tear something up. Well, we save our plans so we can build another, okay? We have experience with gluing everything together. All we got to do is cut out the parts and build to the new. Now, we're glued. That's fine. That's why we have wax paper. Slide your hand underneath. And this pops off like so. Now, we haven't cut our dihedral yet because I wanted to get it off the plan. Get it into a little bit better place to work with. Now here is our wing panel. Congratulations. This one actually went together really fast. But seeing as the last wing panel I built was for a sailplane, it was 100-inch. And my goodness, that's a lot of wing, a lot of stuff. Now I'm just going to take my razor saw and I'm going to cut just on the outside of the line, so I can come back and sand it down a little later. Be patient. It'll cut. Okay. And it's important to try to make your cuts as square as possible. If there are webbing. And then through our bottom spar,
Wait. Like so. Okay, got those out of the way. And I'm going to flip it around here so I can see the trailing edge. What's up, buddy? Okay. And don't forget to cut to the outside of the line, outside of your wing panel. And then we'll cut our trailing edge. And that, my friends, is a wing panel. And we have a little overlap outside here of the wing tip. And I'm just going to very carefully saw that, and I'm going to use the rib as a guide, but being careful not to saw into the rib. The spars are hard, but just be patient, and they will saw. Just be patient with them. We're going to go ahead and stay where our spar was. Get that down to the rib. And the trailing edge down. And then our leading edge. Boom. There we go. We got one half of our wing for our PT-20. Now, I'm not going to bore you to death with building the other one. You've watched me build one already. So I'm going to go ahead and cut out of here. I'm going to set my wing panel off to the side, and I'm going to go ahead and build the other half. And then we'll come back when it's time to join our wing halves. Okay, and then we'll have a complete wing. We'll catch you on the other side. Okay, here we are. We have both of our wing halves built. They're good and straight. The dihedral angle looks pretty good. So it's time to join them. So before we do that, there's a few parts that we need to make, such as our wing joiners, and they're actually in the shape of the dihedral we're going to use. So let me wipe the workbench off here, and we'll get started. Okay, first thing we needed to do was go punch out all of our wing joiners. They're all the pieces that look like this. You're going to have different thicknesses where they go in different places on the airplane wing. You'll have a forward joiner, two center joiners, an aft joiner, and all your other joiners in between, leading edge joiners and trailing edge joiners. In other words, it's going to be a light ply joint at every spot on our wing. And the first thing we need to do is get our center joiners that are our little skinny guys like this. These are actually designed to fit right in like so, okay? We want to slide that. We're not gluing yet, okay? We're just fitting. And what that should do, that should go right up against the rib. And wow, okay, cool. It worked. It should go right up against the rib like so, okay? And fit snugly between our spars. And then right where that is bent should be where our wing halves join. And we're going to do the same thing on our backside. Boom. There we go. Just like so. All right. Okay, what I did right quick, just to make sure, went ahead and slid together our two wing halves just with our center joiner, just to make sure it was going to fit. Doesn't say to do so in the manual, but I just wanted to make sure that way if there's anything that we needed to correct in our build, we could go ahead and do so. That looks pretty darn good. Slide these bad boys back apart, and it's a pretty nice little fit. Okay, a couple more things I want to do. Go ahead and slide everything back together. like so. What we have, you notice we have several different joiners here of different sizes. We're going to go ahead. We have leading joiner, leading edge, LEJ. We'll go ahead and take this bad boy, set it in here. We're just looking, okay, making sure everything looks good. That looks wonderful. And we have our two other joiners that's going to go on our spars. You have an AJ, an aft joiner, and a forward joiner on our spar. You notice one a little bit shorter than the other, and that's to go underneath the forward spar of the spar. So we'll just take this thing, slide it in there, make sure we're not poking out anywhere. That looks really good as well. It's all internal and tucked. And we're going to take the aft joiner that goes aft the spar. Wow. That fits really well. I'm surprised. Usually you have to do some sanding, you know, to adjust. And then we have the trailing edge joiner. And that'll just go on our trailing edge. And that looks really well. That looks really good as well. All right, so those all look good. Now we got to build our ribs that will actually go in the middle here. Okay, so we'll reset. I'll grab all the parts for those and we'll put them together here in just a minute. Okay, here we are with our center rib parts. We're going to be building wing design A because it's a trainer plane. You're going to learn how to fly with this thing. So we got to make sure we have our two pieces marked A, and then our rear pieces as well. These are going to go like so in the wing later on. All we need to do is go ahead and glue these together. Now, if you notice, there's a line die cut into our rear ribs. Those are there for a reason. That's actually going to be a cutout for our servo when we actually mount our radio equipment. Should be here next week sometime. What I'm going to do is take our medium CA. I'm going to glue these things together. But it's important to stay off of that line where we're going to cut out, because it's going to make life really hard for us later on. You know, always look down the road. So I'm just going to take some of my medium. I'm going to put it there, there, and then through here. This is balsa, so it will wick throughout. And then I'll take our other piece, put them together, get them lined up. Use your finger clamps here, get them together. Hold them for a few seconds. Just kind of smooth any CA ooches out, just kind of use your finger to smooth them together. Smooth it out. Okay. All right, there's that one. And now we have our nose piece, or our rib that goes up front. If you notice, it has a hole in it. What we're going to do after we get this cut out or glued together, I'm going to extend that line on down past the front, because that's where our dowel is going to go for our wing mounting. So, same process. Go ahead and put glue all around. Just put a drop up right there and right there. We want to make sure that glues together well, because we're going to cut it out later. Just like so, finger clamp it together so it has a minute to tack up, and then we'll set it off to the side. Actually, we're going to go ahead and notch this out. We're going to, remember, follow this line. And what I do, I'll take my hobby knife and just lay it up against there and use it as a guide. And boom, just like that on that one. Same way for the bottom. Now use an even pressure, because this will separate and snap. We don't want to break it. Remember, balsa is very fragile. It should come down to the corner, just like so. All right. There we go. Now we're notched out for or dowel. Alright, we'll set them off to the side for a second. I'm going to read ahead in the manual a minute. Okay, one thing I'm going to do, kind of help us on down the road. I'm going to take our forward jointer. You got to have like 8 hands to do this, and it works out. And then what I'm going to do, I'm just going to kind of hold that in place. And I'm going to go ahead and draw where this hole needs to be in our leading edge, and I'm going to go ahead and cut that out. So bear with me here. Okay, what I'm gonna do, I've got our slots marked where they need to be. I'm just gonna take a 1/4-inch dowel that came with the kit, and I'm wrapping some sandpaper around it, and I'm gonna go back in there and I'm gonna sand. Sand it out like so. About half the diameter of the rod. It goes pretty darn quick with this 3M stuff. Not like that. There you go. Slick as a whistle. And I'll go ahead and mention it while I'm working on this. Need to get some clamps and stuff ready for the next step. We're actually going to be mixing some epoxy. And it'll be this will be the last run for today. Because I have a birthday party I need to get ready to go to. So go ahead and we're going to cut away for a minute. I'm going to grab some clamps. And we're going to epoxy our wing halves together, okay? Okay, here we are. We have everything lined up, ready to go. We've got plenty of hobby clamps ready. I've got my 30-minute epoxy ready. All of our wing joiners lined up, ready to go, because this is for real. This is not a test. We're going to do it for real this time. So first thing we want to do, of course, is mix up our epoxy. It's always better to have more than not enough, so we'll go 20 drops. That's our resin. And our heart. Go ahead and get that mixed up. If you want to see exactly the tricks of the epoxy, go back to part 2 of the fuselage build. I kind of went into detail on the epoxy part of it. If you don't get it right, you're going to have a sticky mess like honey. Okay, the first ones we're going to do will be our center joiners, our 2 thin ones. And I just want to coat the inside piece at this point. I want to go from the middle to the outside. Go ahead and slide that into place like so. Then we're going to get the inside piece to the back side joiner. Just like so when we test fitted everything. Okay, now we're going to get the insides out. That's fine. Of our joiners. Have some paper towels on hand because some will ooze out. Just like that. Okay. Now, we're going to take our forward joiner and coat the inside with epoxy. Like so. Slide it right into place. Now I'm on top of wax paper here, so if that slides down, it doesn't affect our building table. We get our after joiner. And we coat the front side with epoxy. Like so. Get that into place and make sure we're not exactly touching the table at this point. It can get messy. Okay, get that out of the way for now. You don't want to rush this part, but you do want to work because you have a whole lot to do in a short amount of time. Put a clamp there. Let me go ahead and put a clamp there as well. And you notice our wings just waving around in space out here. We're going to remedy that right now. I'm just going to get a piece of wood and just clamp it. Just kind of take some of the stress off of it. Just like that. You don't want to overdo it and get everything lined back up. So, we're going to take our leading edge joiner and coat it. And you notice it's notched out, and that's for the wing dowel for mounting. Go ahead, get that in place. Clamp on that, and then we'll get a clamp on the other side. This is the time to set the alignment on your leading edge. Make sure you can everything is lined up, because once this epoxy dries, it's a done deal. Okay, our hole is lined up. Okay, center and front looks excellent. Now, time for this little guy, our trailing edge joiner. Go ahead and get two clamps ready for that. We'll coat one side. Believe it or not, we're almost done for today. We'll come back tomorrow after the epoxy sets and do some more. Remember, 30 minute epoxy, 30 minute set time, 24 hour cure time. I want to go ahead, and before we do anything more with the wing, go ahead and just let it cure that way. It's not an issue. Alignment is everything at this point, so don't screw it up. All right, that looks good. Trailing edges are matching up. Leading edges matching up. Our dihedral looks awesome at this point. That quick, that simple, we now have a wing. Okay, we're far from done, but we have a wing. We have a viable wing. Once we cover it, it will produce lift, and I believe it'll fly really well. Meanwhile, while this epoxy cures, I'm gonna go spend some time with the family, have a cup of coffee, and I think we got a birthday party to go to here in a little bit. So we'll pick back up tomorrow where we left off. And make sure this is an area where your kitty cat's not gonna jump on the table and knock it off. The kids aren't going to be playing ball by it or anything like that, because shit happens. I know it happened here. So just walk away from it at this point and enjoy the rest of the day. We'll see you guys later.